I'm going to let all the guests introduce themselves so you're familiar with who they are, where they come from. Some of them obviously are from the film, but others are less well known. So I'll just start with Dr. Random again.
Yes, hello. I wasn't in the film, but I am one of those honey badger people. I'm not a girl, though. It's complicated.
Hi, I'm Katie John Wendt. I'm fairly well known in sort of Norwich. I would say I'm a gender activist, but I hope that is inclusive.
Mike Buchanan, leader of the political party Justice for Men and Boys and the Women Who Love Them, the only political party in the English-speaking world campaigning on many fronts for the human rights of men and boys.
Hi, I'm Jess Austin. I'm doing my PhD at Anglia Ruskin University. I specialise in things like feminist concepts and things like that.
My name's Lucinda Bray. I set up a theatre company working for and with anyone affected by sexual and domestic abuse.
I'm Paul Elam, founder and publisher of avoiceformen.com.
I'm Erin Pitsey. I founded the Refuge Movement for All Victims of Domestic Violence and believe passionately from my own experience and everything I've done is that domestic violence is not and never has been gendered. It's a generational family issue.
And I'm Cassie Jay, the filmmaker that you just watched for 2 hours. Could I ask a question? I would love to hear what the feminists on the panel thought of the film.
Well, this is probably going to surprise you, but I really, really enjoyed it. And there were lots of things in it that I think we'd all been aware of. And, you know, sometimes those don't get highlighted, and it's a real shame. There was no boring bits at all. It made me laugh. Did make me cry at one point when they were talking about men committing suicide when they couldn't get their children. That really affected me. And yeah, so I really enjoyed it. And I think you did a really good job. And thank you very much. Who wants to have a go?
Okay, I'm nearest. I would fairly echo what Jess has said. Unfortunately, there wasn't anything I knew that I learned. A lot of the stuff that came up, I was already aware of. And I say unfortunately just because a lot of the issues that you're highlighting are things that just shouldn't exist. They shouldn't exist for men, they shouldn't exist for women. And having worked in post-16 education here for the last 5 years, I have seen the amount of young men who are going through really, really difficult things and struggle to articulate that and don't feel that they're given the space to articulate that because they have to be this kind of person, and that process has affected me. So I'm really, really glad that somebody has made this. I don't think it would necessarily make me question my feminism as such, but I'm really glad that that voice is out there. So thank you.
Yeah, you're not going to get the polarized opposition you might have expected. Very positively received the film. I could pick apart statistics and examine bits behind them and qualifications, but in general, I agreed with it all. And it's again sad. I mean, there were some great statements in there about if you want to understand male experience, you've got to listen to men. It's got to go both ways, the listening experience. And one of the things I've done is I've been running a gender and sexuality discussion group in Norwich for the last sort of 5 years. It kind of started out as a feminist group, but we wanted to make it about all genders and all sexualities. That meant straight, gay, everything in between, male, female, and everything in between. I'm one of those. And it has been a struggle over 5 years to get male voices in that group. And initially, the only voices we could get were gay voices. And then we got, oh my God, we got a straight guy. How do we keep them? Seriously, it was that hard. And one of the things we've struggled with is people leaving the group because sometimes expressions and dynamics and debates are held more vociferously, and it's been a real struggle to get all the voices heard. But that's something I'm still passionate about, but still trying to find out what kind of platform do you create where you can have these kind of discussions without it turning into a bashback slanging match, which is what also happens. And then I'm also really proud to be on a panel with Aaron, because I now, over the last couple of years, have been working in domestic abuse and sexual violence and actually trying to help with getting it heard that men are victims too, trans people are victims too. In fact, they're the highest statistic of all of the statistics, because they're going through a gender transition within a relationship very often, which also then gets bashed. And I myself have been a victim, both as male and as trans, and at the hands of both men and women. So I know, and there was a best thing that was said in there, I think was probably, we haven't got to stop male violence, we've got to stop violence. And just, yeah, it's brilliant. And it is just starting to treat the issues, not the genders. So yeah, I liked it.
I'd just like to add one thing as well. Please don't give up on feminism just yet. Because I'm guessing you went into the film thinking, when you started researching, oh, all these MRAs are going to be terrible and stuff like that, and then you kind of realised, oh, actually, they're not, they're just normal people. Don't then do that to the feminists and start thinking that all the feminists are SJWs because they're treating the MRAs like that. I really think there's still a place for you in feminism, honestly.
Can I just ask you, just because... what's 50 years since I've been doing this, would you call yourself gender feminist? I mean by that, do you believe that it is the male patriarchy that causes all this?
Me personally, it's more to do with class, I think, especially in this country. I think it's class on whether you do well or not, because we know that white working class boys in particular do terribly in lots of different parts of our society, and that's not because they're boys, it's because they're working class mostly. So I would probably say less of the gender feminism and more sort of structural.
I would definitely echo that as well. I think that it's a socioeconomic problem, particularly, like you said, in this country, where we threw the class system out just after the Second World War, except we didn't actually throw the class system out, we just pretended to. We put people in slightly better houses and made changes to the education policy, and over time, actually, the education policy has created an environment where young men often suffer. So that's what I would say. I don't know if this was to all three of us, but
I think one can be a feminist and an MRA. But then it's a case of which MRA. Well, let me qualify that. We've got the first bit of debate. No. Wait, it's mine. I've got the mic. No, because it's there's something else towards the end. It was like the MGTOW, the MRA, and there were talking about people who wanted to change the system, people who wanted to use the system, people who wanted to leave the system. So when anyone asks me, am I a feminist, equally I would ask the question, what kind of MRA are you, what kind of feminist are you? So I think that works, that's got to work two ways as well, before we end up polarizing feminism versus MRA, and there's only two sides, it's only black, white, it's only male, female. As someone who's lived an experience that's in between in many parts of my life, life cannot be divided into this black and white in that sense. And so, yeah, I would call myself an intersectional feminist, probably. I could probably call myself any number of feminisms, but I wouldn't want to say I am this, that, and the other like that. I want to say I am, these are the things I'm for, and these are the things I want to see changed. So I'd rather be policy-based rather than an ism or an ideology based. And like these guys, we kind of had a little chat just beforehand in the pub about what we saw as a problem. And yeah, I would say capitalism, class, religion. Historically, many religions have been male dominated, but it's about the religion, not necessarily the male in that respect either. I come from a very strong fundamentalist Christian background, which I've left. And so I feel that religion is very often part of the problem. Particularly around things like male genital mutilation, circumcision and everything else like that. No one's trying to stop that because no one wants to stand up to the religions. So
some of us are.
Yeah, well, no, I think people should stand up to it, but it's a lot harder because, you know, that needs to be changed too, and I would advocate against that as well. But if you ask me what kind of feminism, I would probably cite one feminist simply because it's a simple way to cite it to illuminate what is a complex problem, and that is Audre Lorde saying that we don't live single-issue lives. And, you know, we can stand on multiple different issues and battles and stand together on them, male and female, trans and everyone in between, all united, let's stop this. Like, for example, let's end violence, full stop. And that is something we can be united on, and it need not be a them versus us situation. So, you know, Audre Lorde suffered at the hands of white, straight, you know, middle-class feminist because she wasn't those things. And so there was feminist versus feminist. It's not always feminist versus MRA, it's feminist versus feminist too. So I would say stick to the issues and not the genders in that sense, even though obviously some things are experienced in a gender way.
I would like to take a moment to answer some of that, please, just a moment, if you'll bear with me. First of all, I get it. It is. And I think it's important that we have this kind of discussion, that there are people of differing philosophies at the same table hearing what each other have to say. That being said, I would remind everybody that we had to hide the location of this movie. And it wasn't because of capitalists, okay? It was because of feminists. Aaron Pitsey was stalked and terrorized back in the 70s. It wasn't capitalists that did it. It was feminists that did it. When A Voice for Men sponsored the first international conference on men's issues in Detroit, the hotel received death threats that people were going to come there and shoot guests and shoot attendees indiscriminately, so that we ended up having to move the venue. Those threats of death didn't come from capitalists. They came from feminists. Feminism does have, and I'm not taking anything away from anybody sitting on this panel now, feminism has a long, unending history of violence and oppression against any dissent. And it is not talked about in the feminist community to any meaningful level. It is something that might be a nice platitude at a party or even a gathering like this. But are feminists in academia, the mainstream, anywhere else really discussing the violence and destruction, the attacks on the family that have come down at the hands of feminists? No, we're not. And we've got a long way to go until that happens.
I'd just like to ask the two ladies in the middle who have described feminism as a socioeconomic situation, as I understand it, correct me if I'm wrong. If it's socioeconomic, why do you call yourself feminist? And my second question, I'd like to press the point, do you believe in patriarchy?
Yes, I do believe in patriarchy, because I do believe that we are oppressed by a certain socioeconomic group. And I think with feminists and with MRAs, I think one of your problems is rich men, rich upper class men. A lot of the men who are doing, who are disposable, and I did really like that point in the film, they're working class and nobody cares about them because they're not rich, they don't have power. So, yes, I do believe in the patriarchy in that sense. But men suffer under it as well. I guess that sort of answers your question. So I'll pass it over from my point of view.
I think from my point of view, I'm not saying that feminism is about socioeconomic things. From my point of view, that there are a whole load of problems that are brilliantly highlighted on this list over here from Justice for Men and Boys that could be translated in a different and unique way to women that are caused by problems of wealth spread and the sharing of wealth. I believe that historically, in answer to your question, to fully answer your question about do I believe in a patriarchy, I do believe that the Houses of Commons have been filled with men for the last few hundred years. I do believe that the Bible was translated by men. I do believe that the Houses of Lords have been filled with men up until relatively recently. So I believe that our society as a model has patriarchal elements and that we are still dealing with those. I agree with Jess that they affect men, young men, equally to women, and that it's not gender specific. I hope that answers your question.
If it's not gendered, how can it be about, how can you talk in terms of patriarchy and feminism? Clearly it is gendered. And the second point is to Jess, that you indicated that you believed in a form of patriarchy, indicating that it was one socioeconomic group. Am I wrong, correct me if I am, in saying that I believe that that group is white, wealthy, older men?
Yes, you would be correct, because that is what I said. I do believe that it is a class situation. If you just look at demographics of people in, you know, the high-powered jobs, with the Fortune 500 in the documentary, they said only 4% are women. What I would love to see is what are the demographics of the 96% who are men, because I highly doubt a lot of those men are not well educated and not from good families. There won't be very many who are working class in the Fortune 500. I just, you know.
I'll relinquish the microphone now. Thank you for making your position absolutely clear. Thank you.
Hi there, my name's Andy Thomas. I've got two questions, one for the feminists and one for Paul Elam. First of all, listening to the feminist speak, it would seem that they've become confused about what they mean by patriarchy. And my question is rather than go through this exercise of mental gymnastics to try and justify it, would it not be more intellectually honest to come out and say that you're having doubts on this now? And my other question to Paul Elam is, what's been the hardest thing about setting up a voice for men, and what's been the most rewarding experiences you've had in running a voice for men and campaigning on behalf of men and boys?
As you've heard quite a lot from the feminists, I think it would be best for Paul to answer your question first, and then I will happily answer your question.
Thanks for the question, Andy. What has been the hardest thing? Undoubtedly, the vicious attempts by the mainstream media to malign me as a person, to destroy my reputation, to bring harm and pain into my life that gets transferred to my partner and to other people that are close to me. The feminist-inspired attacks on my work, and the cherry picking and the mischaracterizations and the outright yellow journalism has made it hard. It's also made me a lot more determined. To answer you about the most rewarding thing, that's really simple for me. I forgot your name down here on the end.
Katie.
Mentioned the trouble keeping, okay, we got a straight white male, what do we do with him? And how do we get this person to stay and to share their experience? What I found through my work is that through a willingness to hear that man's experience in the way he damn well wants to express it, without expectations, that it meets an ideological litmus test, that it meets some sort of politically correct standard, that we listen to men where they're at, what's hurting them, listen to their anger, Because one of the biggest problems in this culture is we do not want to hear men be angry about anything. Oh, they took your kids? Oh man, that's too bad, have a beer. We can talk about it for 2 minutes. And after that, even from their friends, they don't want to hear it. This society does not care about the pain of men, and this society doesn't care about the pain that is generated with injustice that you just saw 117 minutes of on this screen. Society doesn't care about it at all. We can differ on what the root is for all that, but the benefit, just to answer your question, is the reward that I get every time I get an email or every time one of my clients says something like, I wish my father had reacted this way. I wish I could even think about myself in the way that you're suggesting. And I'm not suggesting rocket science. I'm just suggesting that there's no shame in being a man.
Thank you. So just to re-clarify what you're asking, which is that you feel that I've become confused at what patriarchy is, and that you would like to suggest that as a result of watching this film, I have changed my perspective on that.
Yeah, it sounds like you're going through a series of gymnastics about whether patriarchy is some socio-economic phenomena rather than gender, but we call it patriarchy. It's always been called patriarchy, and in effect that men like me are branded in a negative way, stereotyped. So this is about gender, but listening to the three of you speak now, it sounds like you're trying to paint it as it's not really about gender, it's just so it's a socio-economic phenomenon.
Oh, does it sound like we're trying to put it to one side?
Sounds like a very confused perspective.
Okay.
And it would be better if you have any doubts about this to come out and say that rather than try and justify it.
That's
my question. Is it not better? Is it not more honest?
Okay. I don't feel that it is, because for me, I see the patriarchy as it's the patriarchal system. In the same way that I have a lot of male friends and I don't look out at the room full of quite majority men and think you're trying to oppress me, you are the patriarchy. What I think of as the patriarchy are the people that have made the laws in this land, the people that decide on policy in this land, and for a long time, they have been men. Now, what seems to be happening from my perspective, just from where I am, is that we have a whole lot of problems in our country and in our culture, so American and British alike, and they are starting to hit men very, very hard, I think, and the kinds of men that I am looking out on right now. But I don't think those problems are coming from a reaction to feminism. I think these problems are coming from a reaction to policy. Some of those policies, at the end of the day, if you want to stop male genital mutilation, it's got to come from Parliament. It's not the feminists that are stopping that.
Can I just make a point very quickly about genital mutilation? Prior to the FGM Act in 1985, which is, 32 years ago now? Prior to it and now, both female and male genital mutilation were illegal. Male genital mutilation is illegal. It's been illegal since at least the 1861 Offences Against a Person Act. I'm not aware of a prominent feminist anywhere in the world today that is calling for an end to male genital mutilation. So much for bloody feminism.
I wanted to ask Paul the question I asked him earlier. You saw a little clip of where you talked about some women having a fantasy of rape. I don't know if that was the actual headline. I only caught a faint glimpse of it. I wanted to give you clarify that in a moment. And what I wanted to ask the feminist panel is, you saw the more radical women who shut down Warren Farrell, who have forced us to be here, the Norwich feminist movement who boycotted this film entirely. How much responsibility do you feel to combat that side of feminism that would seem toxic, frankly? Ladies first, I guess.
Oh, sorry, it's just because it sounded like
sorry,
the last
question
was for us.
Sorry, that was just a joke.
Sorry.
I'm so sorry.
Do you know what? It really, really annoys me a lot of the time, because you obviously came as wearing the glasses in the front. You obviously came thinking that we were going to be a certain type of feminist. Well, you seem to think that there's only one feminist theory about patriarchy and things like that. Now, the problem with that is there are different types of feminism, and I don't like radical feminism. It really annoyed me, the fact that there was someone telling me that I was not allowed to watch this film and that they were going to protest it, and I just wasn't allowed to see it. That's, to me, that is not feminism, that's censorship.
That is feminism.
It's a part of feminism, it's a type of feminism. There are different types. It's like the fact, I'm sure, that there are extreme MRAs and then there are the normal ones. There are going to be different types.
But the radical feminists control the establishment. That's the difference. Anyway, you got the microphone, I'm sorry.
But yeah, so unfortunately, I think it did upset me that there were some people who just didn't want to engage. And I think that's one of the problems that feminism does face, in the fact that they're, from the radicals in particular, they don't want to talk about it. And this is why we're having problems for males. The fact that you're not allowed to talk about domestic violence. You're just not allowed to talk about it, because otherwise you're going to be told, oh, well, women have it worse. And that's from a certain type of feminist. We do have these problems and we should be combating it. And I'm well aware that I will probably get backlash for saying it. I'm well aware of that.
But how much responsibility do you feel, like how much do you want to combat that side of feminism? What do you try to do to combat that side of feminism? That's what I guess I'm asking.
Yeah, sure.
And not just you, all three.
Well, I mean, I'm doing my PhD at the moment, and it is quite a left place to be. And unfortunately, you do just have to carry on saying it. I have been shut down before. I have suffered abuse through doxing and emails for basically saying my feminist views. It's still feminist, but it's not popular, unfortunately. I guess the way I'm, me personally, the way I'm going to combat it is, when I eventually do become a lecturer, I want free speech. And in my classroom, people can say what they want. I mean, I don't have the answers. And obviously, John will tell you about the way he does it, because he does very open spaces.
Yeah, I mean, I've been commenting in the various, you know, feminist groups online in Norwich over the last few days, trying to explain, because some misinformation had been put out. For example, one piece of misinformation that I saw was that that only one feminist had been asked to be on the panel in order for it to be weighed against them. So I immediately set about correcting, you know, things like that. So, and I wanted to encourage people to come here, and, you know, and I was, you know, and I understood some people's reactions, but not their responses. And the reactions are only going to stay as reactions and not become understanding if they avoid and stay away. So I'm hoping for the fact that tomorrow night's showing will actually be able to get out there now, and hopefully us putting responses online tonight and tomorrow morning will encourage people to come along tomorrow and find out it's not what they expected, and that they can learn from it, that they can hear male voices within it, that the film is not one-sided, that the panel isn't one-sided. So I'm interested in making sure that information gets out there. And as I say, I've had the experience from someone who sits between two gender worlds in many respects of you know, of feminists saying, you know, well, we don't want anything to do with you if you're going to endorse their rights too. And it works both ways. So I've experienced that. I've had death threats for speaking in public in free speech environments and things. So you get that from people, full stop. It doesn't necessarily, again, have to be specifically gendered. But I'm interested in critical gender theory, critical of feminism, critical of anything. But going back briefly to the question about the patriarchy, I think there's an historical aspect to how power has grown in nations up until 50, 70 odd years ago. But in the last 50, 70 years, yes, power and balance has shifted. And one of the things that the women's liberation movement, that early forms of feminism were seeking to do, was to bring out some degree of gender equality. And some of those things have been achieved. And in some respects, clearly some things seem to have gone too far the other way. If you certainly listening to some quite shocking things about, it seems, American paternity suit laws and things like that, which I'm hoping aren't as bad over here, but I suspect they're not. Exactly. So that's what I mean. I was hoping that Britain wouldn't be as bad in that case. If it's as bad, then yeah, who has made those laws? And is it, as you were saying earlier, is it about policies and policymakers? Is anyone going to go down and sit down and work out, was it a female policymaker, a male policymaker, or a male feminist policymaker? You know, where is the issue there? There are policies that need changing.
I want to echo some agreement with you. And this is something that I've said for a long time. You know, it is not, for the most part, feminist judges that are hitting down gavels in courtrooms, ripping children away from their fathers. It is not feminist pediatricians that are mutilating our boys. There are a lot of problems in our species that have to do with gender roles, and feminists were right about part of that thing. Where I think feminists really missed the boat, though, is understanding, and again, and I'm one of these people, I gotta say, I agree with Herbert, the whole patriarchy thing falls totally flat on me. And it's not because there isn't any merit to understanding that, yes, name and title and land were passed down from father to son. That was real and still is in a lot of ways. The problem here is that we take the word patriarchy, and just like everything else that feminists do, they narrow it down a gendered lens and look at one side of the story. We don't look at how patriarchy was also, and still is, women and children first. We don't look at the fact that patriarchy is, screw the guy, give the woman the children. Patriarchy, and feminists say patriarchy hurts men too, but I'm sorry, it's lip service. The whole arrangement, the whole idea of patriarchy, if you don't view it also in its context with gynocentrism, which is the placing of women's welfare, women's wants, women's desires above everything, even to insane and irrational levels. I've dealt with so many men, 30 years of clinical work with men, and have dealt with men that bordered on suicide because they could not produce enough to make their wife smile. If men are benefiting from patriarchy, we got this shit wrong. But I do agree, we need a critique of what works and what doesn't between men and women. We need that desperately, and we need an unbiased critique, and we need one where women are willing to pony up and sacrifice right alongside men in every way. Pay equality, it's in blistered hands and scars. It's not in the boardroom. It's on crab boats. It's on other commercial fishing vessels. It's in coal mines. And until we start including both sides of this discussion in this, then all we're going to do is go back and forth about, well, here's how women have it, here's how men have it. It doesn't work. That conversation will never produce the needed result. So I can say, ladies, in all honesty, be careful what you ask for, because men's lives are not privileged.
Is it possible, it might have got lost in the whole question that I asked, but I did ask you about the thing before that you saw about a lot of women, about women having rape as a fantasy in their minds. I asked you that when we were talking next to each other as well.
I thought I was going to dodge that.
Sorry.
yes, I wrote an article, another piece of satire of, I guess, 7 or 8 years ago, I wrote a series, 8, maybe 10 pieces of very, very juvenilian satire, meant to be offensive. This one is in response to rape culture hoopla, another one of the big canards of modern feminism, that all men are potential perpetrators, that they need to be watched, that they need to be trained not to rape. And it was an antagonistic response. But like all the pieces that I wrote that are satire, I made it real obvious. And in a lot of those pieces, I said, hey, this is satire. I'm not serious. And what the media does is they take those pieces, and even Cassie J over there did the same thing to me. She stuck it in the movie. But I mean, it was a fair thing to stick in there because I did write it. But it was satire.
I just must ask everybody a question about rape fantasy. Why is it that 5 million women bought all three novels called Shades of Grey? If anybody can answer me that, I would be interested. What? But why would anybody, man or woman, want to read three novels all about... But it's all rape. The whole thing's about raping. But that's my question, you know, if we're all talking... Yeah, that's what you wrote. But I'm just saying, rape fantasies...
A fantasy is make-believe.
About rape.
And it actually happens.
But about rape.
Yeah, it's about BDSM relationship, supposedly.
Yeah, but that's abusive to... It's according to the radical feminists, it's abusive towards women. It's not, written by a woman.
As rape, it's presented by the author as a BDSM relationship. It's not the same thing.
But why would women want to...
She signed the contract in the book. You don't sign
I wrote a satire piece on rape fantasies that used rape fantasies.
You're ignoring everything I'm saying.
Oh, I'm sorry. Can we get her on microphone?
I think you make a really good point at the back there. It's a story written about BDSM, a BDSM relationship. You make a really good point that BDSM looks pretty abusive from the outside. It's a really complicated place, and I can see your point that it's like, well, if women didn't fantasize about it, why are they fantasizing about this? Why are they buying this book? But actually, a lot of it is about that kind of voyeuristic, ooh, what are they up to? Ooh, that's a bit titillating. Because another problem with our society is we just don't talk about sex enough. We don't talk about it from either side, and that's what drives a lot of sexual violence underground. And it's one of the huge influencing factors in why men don't feel able to come forward sometimes and admit that. So I don't know if the lady at the back's got anything else she wanted to say.
No, not now, thank you.
Cool.
May I?
Thank you for that. I just want to add that acknowledging the reality that a lot of women do indeed fantasize about rape, which is true. You can find it in Masters and Johnson. You can find it in all kinds of empirical research, is not excusing actual rape. I did not do that. I acknowledged that there were fantasies. So making that leap as though I shouldn't acknowledge that women fantasize about rape to being somehow rape apologia or rape excuse, too big of a jump. It just isn't there.
I'd just like to pick up on an earlier point that, is it Lucinda, I think, made earlier on, about the predominance of men in Parliament and passing laws. And feminists tend always to think, well, it's mostly men that did it, therefore they must be passing laws to advantage men. That simply isn't the case. I mean, if you look at the criminal justice system, if men were sentenced with the same leniency as women in the criminal justice system, 5 out of 6 men currently in British prisons would not be there. And I look forward to feminists campaigning for more women in prison.
Well, if you do something bad, if a woman raped a man, if a woman seriously sexually assaulted a man, she should go to prison. So, a woman can seriously sexually assault a man. This is absolutely possible. This is true. It is called serious sexual assault. That is the law. My initial usage of the word is correct. A woman can be prosecuted for seriously sexually assaulting a man, but not for rape. How many judges that sit on the majority of criminal cases are women?
What's your point there?
Well, your point is that men are receiving tougher sentences for the same acts as women.
From both male and female judges.
Okay, but the majority of judges are men, and our legal system works through precedent. Therefore, the precedent has been set by men against men.
That's because we live in a completely gynocentric culture. Men are provisioning for women. It's another way that men are provisioning for women.
Do you know why this concept of gynocentric is really interesting to me? Do you know where it comes from?
I don't actually know where it comes from, no.
Well, if we think about, we're talking about historic roles, and the fact we need to change these roles. We desperately need to change these roles, these gender roles. You've spoken very eloquently about it. You've made a beautiful film about it. This sense of gynocentric comes from the same place that caused the horrific death of all of those Boko Haram boys, that traditionally, men have been the power, men have been the fighters, men have been the ones to go to war, men have been the ones that have been conscripted, sent to slaughter. And women have been needed for the production of the race. So there is an element of gynocentricity, if you like, because historically we needed to be protected so we could continue to be fertile. Our value was in our fertility. Our value was in our ability to bear children.
I feel I'm being lectured.
I'm ever so sorry. It's the teacher in me. I can't help it.
No, I don't mind hearing an opinion. It's the tone, not the opinion. It's the tone. Yes, I'm speaking. I'm sorry. Would you like the mic?
As a woman, I find that feminists, they treat me particularly negatively when I tell them that I am not interested in having equality in the way that feminists want. I also believe, and have spoken to many women and researched, that most women do not want to be CEOs. They do not want to be MPs in Parliament. They don't want to be Prime Minister. Purely because they just don't. They want to have their children and their family, and some of them want to have their own businesses. Some of them do want that. But the majority of women, I find, do not want that kind of responsibility. I've spoken to someone who is a high-level lawyer, and they were telling me about how they meet all these brilliant graduates in law school, and as soon as the woman meets a guy that she's interested in, she gets married, she doesn't want to work 80 hours a week anymore. And guess what? Her husband does, because he wants to provide for his family. And unfortunately, I don't think the feminists are listening to women, everyday women. They don't want to have 50% of the boardrooms male and female. They want people to be in the boardrooms who are there for merit, as Mike Buchanan always likes to point out, yeah? Because they want to be there. And unfortunately, it seems that most women don't want that. And it requires hard work to do those kinds of senior professions. And it also requires hard work to do things like be a bin man and work in a construction site. Women also don't want to do those jobs either. So I just would like a lot of feminists and the critique that I hear from them, stop shaming women and telling them that they have internalized misogyny and that they have, they are, what's the word? They are, someone help me here, betraying the hard work that feminists have done. I always thought when I was initially attracted to feminism that it was about choice. And if a woman wanted the choice to be a stay-at-home mom or have a little part-time business and not be in the boardroom and have all that responsibility, then it was her choice. And these days, whenever I tell people, no, I'm not going back to work, no, I'm not taking maternity leave, no, I don't want to do that, I get looks like I'm betraying and I've done something wrong. So I feel like I'm here on behalf of all those women that get told they are gender betrayers, letting the side down, all the other words that you can think of. So I'd like a response to that. Thank you.
See, unfortunately, I feel like well, you do realise you're preaching to the choir on that. Unfortunately, I think you were all expecting that we were going to be sort of radicals and things like that. We're not. We're just normal feminists. And I completely agree with you. People do look down on the homemaking choice now, the being a stay-at-home mum. Some feminists do that. That is a fact. Sorry, I can't hear you. No, not at all.
Repeat it to the mic, the question.
Oh, the question was, do I believe that boardrooms should be 50% male and women? No, I don't. No, I don't. So I don't believe that you should ever have 50% women, 50% male in boardrooms, companies or anything. It's not practical. It should always go to who's best for the job. And also, I find it terrible if we're saying, because we're now going to say to women, you can have this job just because you're a woman. Sounds a bit weird, doesn't it? Because that's what some feminists want.
The ones that make government policy are doing that.
I can't.
So she said the feminists who make our policies. The feminists who make the policies are like that.
Yeah. Well, it's usually the loudest minority, isn't it, unfortunately? You know, why do you think that MRAs get such a bad rap? It's because they report on the minorities. It's the same with feminists as well. I find it really hard to say I'm a feminist because I know exactly what people think when I say it.
Are the radicals a minority?
Radical too. Are the radicals a minority?
Feminists. I have no idea. I can't give you, because I don't think I'm particularly radical, but I've been told today that I am. So if I'm the baseline for radical, then possibly, I don't know. But in answer to your question, because you wanted to know what I thought, I live with a 70-year-old woman. She is awesome. Some of you may have seen her at various rallies and stuff, and she fought for feminism. Like, not like me, turning up to one panel discussion, being like, oh, I'm a feminist. No, she got out there and she fought. She made sure people had contraception access if they needed it. And we sit and talk about feminism a lot. And she's like, I fought for a choice. I fought for a choice for women that want to go into the boardroom. Great. If you want to go into the boardroom, if you want to fight that battle, great. If you want to go into the army and be a general, great. If you want to do that thing that women are built to do that I can't do, then great. Like, you, all of those things need a place. And it's bloody good that people can take all of those roles. And I'm glad, I'm ashamed that I am part of a movement that has made you feel that you are betraying anyone. I am ashamed for that.
That's the problem of all time. We're encouraged to point the fingers at each other and say, you're the problem, you're the problem. This minority, that minority, this majority, the white people who have got all the money, all, even that. The point is, we need a different culture.
Yeah.
And it needs to be in the communities, in our neighborhoods, where people of different backgrounds and gender and race and religion, and they need to be with each other, hearing from each other, getting to know each other, and building something that's not always about pointing the finger of protest. Protest has a place, fighting has a place, but maybe we need to be fighting for a different, building a different culture now.
I agree. I think we've reached a time when
Power is with us at the grassroots.
And we need to be fighting for human-based rights, not gender-based rights.
The problem is the model. It needs to be made obsolete by a different model that people want to be part of. And that's a big challenge. And it's easy to get distracted from that challenge. That is the challenge.
And that's treating everybody as a person first, not a male or a female or anything in between.
A human being.
Exactly, starting with the human-centric.
And helping each other practically.
As opposed to gyno-centric or any andro-centric stuff. I also echo what the other woman was saying on the steps earlier about there is a degree to which any rights movement sounds like it's asking for equality, but reality is it's asking for a degree of selective equality and a degree of choice. And that's inevitable because they're looking at where they feel disadvantaged and they're going for those things. And then, as we've been saying all along, I think that we're not acknowledging that there's a two-way street. And the bigger issues are actually about, say, gender roles, which affects people in every direction. And if we're going to say that feminism has been arguing for some degrees of selective equality and selective choice, then we've got to give those same choices and selective equalities to men asking for them as well. Now, if we're going to say that women should have the right to go into the professions where 93% of them might suffer an increased risk of workplace death that is currently more male, then women should have the rights to go into those professions. But men should also have the rights to be homemakers. Men should also have the rights to equal access to their kids. Well, the point is, you can't have rights going one way, and if it has gone the other way on the swing and on the balance, it needs to move not even just back the other way, but forward to a human-centric, everyone has choice, everyone has equality.
Before we continue, we're running out of time, so if we could do one more question and then all the panelists have one more say, and then everyone be done.
I'll preface my question with saying it's a wonderful film. You're absolutely a super lady, but I'm perplexed because your film was 117 minutes long, and the issue which I feel most strongly about amongst all this the men's issues is MGM, despite the fact that you spent months, according to what I heard in the film, researching the issue, you contained your coverage of it to just over a minute out of 117 minutes. Yet, I know for fact that, I mean, you're addressing a US audience principally, I think, and in the US, upwards of 80% of men are victims of MGM, and that of a population of 151 males, that's over 100 million, well over 100 million. And I can't quite fathom how you managed to compact it all into just over a minute in a documentary which went into great detail. And I'm not knocking, but everything you've done was fabulous, but I'm just a bit mystified. And I will also, just while I'm here, I'll read you, because something else that's not been mentioned. And I think there's a big blue pill problem in society about MGM. And another thing that's never been mentioned at all tonight is matriarchy. And I'll just read you a quick sentence from an article written by Dr. William Morgan in 1966, entitled The Rape of the Phallus, where he says that perhaps not least of the reasons why American mothers seem to endorse the operation with such enthusiasm is the fact that it is one way an intensely matriarchal society can permanently influence the physical characteristics of its males. And I think that's a lot of the problem is that a lot of the males you said there, a lot of MRAs disagree on this because a lot of them think it's okay to be cut because the women like it.
Okay, I'll speak to the first issue of why male genital mutilation is less than a minute long in the film. And my first edit had a 20-minute edit on male genital mutilation. I cut it down to 15, and then I cut it down to 5 minutes. And the amount of arguments that people who really want to hold on to circumcision as their right, either religious reasons, they had it done and so they want their son to have to look like them, aesthetic reasons, the belief that it prevents STDs, all this misinformation. The amount of arguments around this topic were so vast and took a lot of time to dispel those arguments in a cinematic way where we don't lose the audience and have people immediately leaving the theater because they do not want to question their own circumcision or their sons. So it was a filmmaking choice to keep it to the most impactful moment when I researched this topic for a solid 3 months. I really went down that rabbit hole and followed the money and followed, you know, medical institutions and the doctor, all of that. And it really impacted me along my journey learning about this topic, as well as the wage gap and rape culture and many other topics that I didn't go further into in this film. So it was a filmmaking choice rather than my personal heart on this matter. And when I saw a procedure done that was a little over 5 minutes long, I cried like never before. And then I showed it to my mom, and that was the quick clip that you saw of me and my mom crying while watching a video. And I showed it to friends and family who were expecting sons, and it changed their lives. So I hope that people go and see medical procedure videos, because that was the tipping point for me. So that's what I chose to include in the film. And I had a lot of, I did test screenings for friends and people in the film industry to see what they thought of the film. And a lot of people told me to take it out, that video of the circumcision. But I adamantly left it in. And I know it's a short segment, but I'm sure many people in this audience felt their heart race when that happened. So I hope people go and research for themselves, and especially if they're expecting a son. Yeah.
This is one way that women do affect men in society, and also that men are made to feel as if, well, that's fine now, and because my mother did that to me. My mother did it to me, and I accepted it for 50 years until I took the red pill, and then I realized.
Hmm. Yeah, I mean, women have a huge advantage and power over men, especially men that they're in a intimate relationship with. And one thing that really impacted me while making this film was realizing my own privilege as a woman, and then coming to terms realizing that so many women know that privilege and abuse it. And that was shocking for me to learn. I guess I was obviously naive in thinking that women don't do bad things, but sure enough they do, and it's often overlooked. And just because we're about to wrap this up, I'd like to say something that, oh, I don't know where she went, Jess. She said there's still a place within feminism for me, so I'd like to speak to that really quick. What really changed my views and eventually why I dropped the label of feminist was because I started psychoanalyzing my own bias against men. And although I heard all these men's rights activists and experts speak on men's issues, and I constantly did want to say what Paul says in the film about we remain so cerebral, yes, that does happen, we should consider that. But when I actually started watching my own video diaries and realizing the extreme bias that I had against men and misandric views, dismissing issue after issue that men face, and seeing that over a period of, it took me 3.5 years to make this film. I only filmed for one full year, but 3.5 years to make it. And I didn't drop the label of feminist until 2.5 years into making the film, so it was a very long journey. But part of why I dropped the label was because when I was a feminist, whenever I discussed gender issues, I wanted to convince the other person of my views rather than really listening to what they had to say. And my goal was always to prove that women have it worse. That was my goal as in my feminist mindset, was yes, but women have it worse. And I don't believe that now. And I think we all need to listen to each other and have compassion for one another and realize we're all in this together. And everything that happened here tonight is exactly what I wanted for this film to inspire is dialogue and healthy dialogue, even if it's uncomfortable at times. So I really appreciate all the panelists that were up here, and thank you all for coming to the screening.